I'd just like you to have a read of what you can see on the screen, everyone. And I'll read it with you. This world in which we live needs beauty in order not to sink into despair. It is beauty, like truth, which brings joy to the heart of man. And it is that precious fruit which resists the wear and tear of time, which unites generations and makes them share things in admiration. And in looking at that, you can think straight away that it was written yesterday. When we look around the world, we see truly a great need for beauty. And we also see a lot of issues happening around the world, especially if we're looking at this point in time in places like Hong Kong and in different states of America and certain situations in the UK. We can see that there is also a lot of despair. And also when we just think about our own, you know, personal situations. And the church is proposing here, and I'll just put up, this is from Pope St. Paul the Sixth from 1965. And this was in a letter that he did to artists. So beauty. Okay, there's three quotes here. And you might look at the first one and recognize who they're all from. And this is what really led me onto this path in about the year 2013, in truly recognizing that beauty has a huge part to play in the way that we teach, the way that we catechize, the way that we evangelize. And these three quotes, lead with beauty. The best evangelical strategy is one that moves from the beautiful to the good and the finally true. So you know there, in recognizing those three words, the beautiful, the good and the true, that we're talking about the transcendentals. And then the last quote, first the beautiful. And, you know, to express that humanly, we can say that that's, oh, how wonderful. And then the good, I want that. I want to be part of that. And finally the true, now I understand. And so this is from Bishop Robert Barron, and he was asked, he's often asked to participate in the big RE conference that happens in Los Angeles. And in quite a few talks that he's given recently, he'll actually say the number one step in evangelization is to lead with beauty. And so that's the name of our presentation today. You probably recognize at least the scene and probably the artist as well here. But what I'd like to do right at this point is to actually start with a prayer that's specifically relevant and reference to this image that we're looking at now. And so I'd like to begin in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and at the hour of our death. Amen. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. I'd like to invite you right now just to contemplate what you're looking at here. Just to slow down, and we have the silence, and I'll be quiet for a little bit now, but just to really take in as much as you can from this painting. I just want you to take in what you're seeing, the colors, the different elements. And just to begin, I'm just going to look at just two details of this painting. And this painting is by Leonardo da Vinci, and it's found in the Uffizi in Florence. Okay, so we're looking at the Archangel Gabriel. And we look at the detail. But what are we drawn to when we have this detail in front of us? What really catches our eye? I'm going to suggest at this point that it's the eye. And I'm going to invite you to wonder, what is Gabriel looking at? What is Gabriel thinking? I'm going to invite you to ask the question, why the flower? What flower? Again, to look at the hair and to ask the question, why the detail? Or to look under the neck and to consider the gold. Now we move to Our Lady. And to think of those words that we just prayed. Hail Mary, full of grace. What is Our Lady thinking? Is she looking at Gabriel's, or is she looking beyond? And then we can go back to the main painting and to give ourselves a bit of context. I just wanted to begin there because at the heart of everything that we're going to just talk about this morning is this movement to contemplation, this invitation to silence, this rigor in using our intellect, in short, to use our whole person. Why are we doing this? So this is from Evangelii Gaudium, 167. Pope Francis says this, every form of catechesis would do well to attend to the way of beauty. Proclaiming Christ means showing that to believe in and to follow him is not merely something right and true. You know, often we come into teaching and just present it as this is what the teaching is. And catechesis had been that way for a long time. But something beautiful. There's a new splendor, a profound joy. This is so human, even in the midst of difficulties. Every expression of beauty can be acknowledged as a path, as an encounter with Jesus Christ. And this is really important because this is where the challenge is to take on something like the way of beauty. We must be bold enough to discover new signs and symbols. That the truth remains the same, but this is talking about new ways to present it, to communicate the word, different forms of beauty which are valued in different cultural settings, including those unconventional modes of beauty which may mean little to the evangelizers, which may mean little to us, but then on the other side prove particularly attractive for the others. This is the challenge, isn't it? Because we often, all of us, come from a particular context. We've had different life experiences. There's different things that attract us. But what Pope Francis is inviting us to do here is to know the other, to know the life that they live in, to seek to understand that and to adapt the way that we catechize, the way that we teach and evangelize to help the other person. So two questions here. You know, what is my definition of beauty? Have I ever tried to describe or define this before. And then just something to make it personal. What is the most beautiful thing you have ever experienced or seen, heard or felt or been a part of? And just in relation to what Pope Francis said in that later quote of Evangelii Gaudium, to actually place ourselves to know the context of the other, it's an important question to ask. And I would invite you to ask this question of other people, because it really opens up the understanding of what beauty is, what people see as beautiful, but to also ask them why. Why is it beautiful? What makes it beautiful? Because my experience is that that question is hardly ever asked. And that it's very, very interesting and quite an education to hear what people are saying in this regard. And so a lot of what Pope Francis says in Evangelii Gaudium actually references an earlier document from 2005 from the Pontifical Council for Culture. And if you Google that term, Pontifical Council for Culture, and then just do a plus the way of beauty, you'll actually find the document probably as a first hit. And I would really encourage you after this to read it, because a lot of what I'll be using here actually is drawn out of that document, because in reality, it synthesizes the church's thoughts and actions in this regard over the centuries. And from what I've read out there from different books and whatever, this is probably by far the best synthesis of the church's approach to the way of beauty. And so it's saying it's a pastoral approach, that is something to help people to come to know Christ. And it's a response to the challenge of our contemporary culture. And it's drawn out of the church recognizing the signs of the times and saying, well, this is something needed. It brought together bishops and experts in this field specifically to talk about the way of beauty as a way to engage with the culture of today, which is relative. We have this major issue of relativism, that my truth is as good as your truth. And you've probably heard the saying, which is, it really hits me every time I hear it, because it's a term of indifference when someone says, oh, whatever. That people, to a great extent, don't care. And a lot of this is in the culture that we live in. Yeah, you can believe what you want to believe. And so one thing that we have to really name from the beginning again is that when we're talking about beauty, it is always associated with truth. That whatever is truly beautiful is always true. And that in using this way of beauty, that we're seeking to build bridges. And the church says this, that it's a privileged itinerary. It's a privileged way, especially to get in touch with those people who have difficulties in receiving the church's teachings. And so when we're talking about being silent and contemplative and recognizing the beautiful, we're always seeking to know the truth of what we're feeling, what we're seeing, and what we're experiencing. And I want you to read this now and to pick out some things that might jump out of you here. The simple experience of the marvel arousing meeting with beauty can open the pathway for a search for God. It disposes the heart and spirit to meet Christ, who is the beauty, or we can say who is beauty incarnate, offered by God to men for their salvation. It invites contemporary Augustines, unquenchable seekers of love, truth and beauty, to see through perceptible beauty, the senses, to eternal beauty, and with fervor discover holy God, the author of all beauty. We could stay with this for so long. We don't have the time. But what strikes you there? Even the language, there's beautiful language there. And I just want to suggest 3 points that jumped out at me. Marvel arousing. What's another word for that? Wonder. Disposes the heart. Everything about the human person meets a crossroads in the heart. And then the action, which is a gift of grace, to be able to see through, to spend the time, to do the hard yards, to do the work that we need to be able to see through, which always starts with prayer, but entails reading, to kind of know, to ask for the grace that I may know, that I may see. And so this is the key question the church asks of us in this engagement with culture, with the engagement with the children in our classrooms. This knowing our context, of knowing these children, which is the beauty that favors the handing on of the faith. What does it mean for that kindergarten child? What does it mean for that child in year four? What does it mean for that class of individuals in year four? What does it mean for the year sevens or the year tens? Which is the beauty? What is going to be the bridge for them? What's going to help them to encounter Christ? So this involves a selection. Which is the beauty? So again, from Florence, from the same museum, the statue of David. People flock there from around the world. What is it in this image? I remember I was there in that museum with my daughter, who had just finished her HSC and who had studied this statue. And she pointed out to me just a few particulars on his arm that she had studied in detail. And she helped me to have an appreciation. Even the hand that you're seeing now, there's been studies of the hand and of the way the veins have been sculptured. And they indicated that the hand that was the model that David used indicated a cardiac problem. Is that the way of beauty? But it's the detail. It's this entry point. It's a bridge. It's this slowing down. It's this entry point into contemplation, into silence. The arts to God's art, to creation. And I just invite you to take any point of reference in this image. It's only an image of the reality. Take yourself into this image. Feel the breeze. What are your questions? What would you look at? I mean, you could stare forever at the mountain, but what about the moss on the rock? What about the stillness of the water? What about the mist playing on the edges of the mountain? Or the drive down to Melbourne at night when we stop and we have a clear sky and it's the space between myself and God. But in that same moment, to know that this God of the universe wants a relationship with me, wants intimate union, communion even, with me, who created me from all infinity, all eternity, to be with him forever. And that myself as a human being, that I'm worth more than planets. I'm worth more than the whole universe because I've been created in love to know God. What about the everyday? In the mess, in destruction, devastation of everyday, to look for the beauty of the everyday. to pause, to see through what can seem to be mundane. This is a refugee camp in Iraq. To look at the ground, to look at the makeshift tents, which are people's homes. But then, in the midst of all of that, to see the radiance upon the young girl's face. To think, what's that young guy thinking there? He's barefoot. But what's he thinking as he looks at the camera? There's beauty there. I asked my daughter, what is beautiful? And she talked about Emma. She talked about Pride and Prejudice. And I just want to play, and hopefully this comes through clearly on your screen. I just want to play a video, just a very video clip. But I just want you to look, what is beautiful here? There's something that comes out when we just slow down.
Come on, young ladies, supper's over. Time to start dancing again.
I am ready, sir.
Ginny's Market.
Who will you dance with?
Why you? If you will ask me.
Will you dance, dear Emma?
What did you see there? Did you notice the change of intonation after Emma asked Mr. Knightley, won't you ask me? He put his glass down. He slowed down. He called her dear Emma. Did you notice the fireplace on the side burning warmly? Did you notice the light touch as they started to dance? Their arms arched over each other, almost like a cathedral. The beautifully chosen music. All of this allows us to enter into contemplation, but first we see the details. We slow down. And we are silent in some way before this mystery that's presented to us. And it's especially true in this scene where we have two human beings, especially a man and a woman here. and we think of Genesis, and we think that man and woman together here are giving us the image of God. Something beautiful. And then again from that document, to say that something is beautiful is not only to recognize it intelligible and therefore lovable, but also in specifying our knowledge, it attracts us. What is attractive here? I have to slow down because otherwise that moment of attraction can pass me by. What captures me here? What is the ray here that ignites the marvel? Beauty tells forth reality itself. And then the last bit, it is its epiphany. And when we talk about epiphany, we're talking about a revelation. So to summarize that, we can say it's intelligible. It attracts us in some way. It tells us a reality, and we can substitute that word for a truth. And then the epiphany, and you know, when we talk about epiphany, we are generally talking about God. Moses before the burning bush, the three kings before the infant Jesus, the epiphany. And then moving more into the sphere of education, and this is from a document that specifically looked at the Common Core education that's across the states, and was in a way a review by some of the top Catholic intellectuals. They have a section in this document after the fall, and you can find this easily online, Catholic Education Beyond the Common Core. It says that beauty can evoke wonder and delight. And I would suggest that in any selection of literature, artworks, experiences or of engagement with creation in whatever way we can, that we're always looking, what can evoke wonder? Mm. And it usually needs depth. I remember being in the Museum of Art in Philadelphia, and you'll probably know it from the Rocky movies where Rocky runs up those stairs, the Philadelphia Museum of Art. And it has so much good art. But then in one particular wing of the museum, it has a lot of modern art in there, and a lot of the modern art is beautiful. But there is sections of that museum where I was in there, and it didn't evoke any wonder. And I was trying to be very aware of how I was feeling, what my experience, what my encounter was like with what is art. But is it beautiful? And I was feeling flat. It did not lift in any way my soul. There was nothing to engage me intellectually. I'm not saying that all modern art is like that at all. I'm not saying that. But I was just saying that there was a lot of art there that did not engage me as a person. And so when we're talking about the privileged way of beauty, the church sees three main paths. It sees the beauty of creation. And we've all experienced this. Beautiful sunsets, the awe that we see on a beautiful day when the sun comes shining through a sunset, where the colors are just painted on the horizon. And you see it on Facebook, you see people taking photos and sharing this. Because it's not enough. It's not enough to hold it inside. It wants to burst through. This is human. It says something about our relationship. This is what we're feeling so much in this separation caused by COVID, that we're made for relationship, that we're made for more. And that's what good art, that's what good experiences of creation in this case want. They want us to share it. Why do we take photos? We want to show people. I know that whenever I've had these great experiences and I haven't been there with my wife, that's the strike to my heart that I feel most, that I want her to be there next to me to be able to share. I want to tell my kids, I want them to be there. The beauty of creation. Then the beauty of the arts. Wonderful poetry. Well-written books. Even stories and storytelling, the way that people can bring you into the picture and make you yearn for that, make you want to experience that. But we're always saying that all of this beauty points us to Christ. Beauty incarnate, beauty made flesh. If you go back and look at that painting by Leonardo, you'll see around the waist of Our Lady, around her womb, you'll see a gold cloth. Most of the time you only see red and blue in Western depictions of Our Lady. But in Leonardo's, around the womb, there's gold. It's gold, the beauty of Christ. Same gold, same color that we use at Easter. I want to share with you one of my favorite all-time videos. It's only a short clip. It's called The Mountain. And this is taken, the footage was taken over, I think, 7 days. The videographer slept in that time only 11 hours because most of the footage was taken in the evening. And you'll see why, because it's taken of the heavens. But then there's details of the mountain itself. And the music is specially chosen to suit the image. It's meant to engage us, to take us into this experience that he had to suffer for. He had to suffer. He was sleep deprived. He had to carry kilos and kilos of video equipment to be able to capture the images. And we know that good art, something that's beautiful, takes effort. And even in our preparation to facilitate the encounter for our students, it's going to take effort. What does the word passion mean when I'm passionate about something? It means that I have to suffer for it. Passio, the passion of Christ. I have to suffer it. So this is a gift. This is a gift. What we're going to see now is a gift from this artist.
Thank you.
to know that God made all of this for us. Why is it so beautiful? Is God reaching out? God wants us to be attracted to him. We're made for him. And this is what St. Augustine, in that so famous few paragraphs from the Confessions, this is what St. Augustine recognized when he spoke about our hearts are restless till they rest in you. Late have I loved you, beauty so ancient and so new. Late have I loved you. Lo, you were within, but I outside, seeking there for you. And upon the shapely things you have made, I rushed headlong, I misshapen. You caught, shouted, broke through my deafness. You flared, blazed. Isn't that what you saw in that video? There was a part in that video where it was red. That wasn't any modification of the video. One evening, a dust storm came from the Sahara. The videographer had to hide in his tent, but he left his camera gear doing the time-lapse playing. And he captured that. God blazed. He lavished his fragrance. I gasped. That's my response. That's what we want to evoke, that wonder. And now I hunger and thirst. You touched me and burned for your peace. Fra Angelico painted this painting. Imagine Augustine here as he has just said those words. You can see next to him the pear tree. And if you do the research, you can find out so much more about the symbolism in this painting. But you can see here this wonder, but then the questioning, what is this? The struggle, because truth asks questions of us. We're not just looking at images. We're not just reading beautiful literature for the sake of having a feeling and letting it pass by. There's an engagement with the truth, that truth asks a question of us. It's not a pointing of a finger. From our side as educators, as facilitators of the truth of Christ, as bridges, it's an invitation, but to be there, to be available. And we remember back what Pope Francis says, we have to enter into the context of those people. And so we've read here the literature, what St. Augustine says. We see here this beautiful artwork. And I just want to play, I won't play all of it, but I just want to play some music that Matt Maher, for those who do secondary education, ACYF. Matt Maher wrote the lyrics and then sang this song in relation to the image that we're looking at now.
I woke up in darkness, surrounded by silence. So where have I gone? I woke to reality, losing its grip on me. Oh, where have I gone? 'Cause I can see the light before I see the sunrise. You I searched for you. What took me so long? I was looking outside, as if love would ever want to hide. I'm finding I was wrong.
It's not for everyone to respond in the same way. But it's for us, the point in that is to look at what is the bridge. And there's a whole variety. There's a whole variety of ways. There's a whole variety of modes of beauty that we will need to use, that we'll need to investigate. But we have to also know that it's beautiful, that there's something of beauty there, that there's an attraction there, there's a truth there, that it can be used as a bridge. But it's important also to understand what some of the barriers can be. And one of the first barriers is this reluctance to slow down. There's a reluctance to give the time. There's a reluctance to listen, to have to do the hard yards, to be rigorous, to actually ask the question, to hear the question, to be receptive. And this is why this word that I have on the screen, receiving. Because human beings are made to give, but also to receive. Sometimes, unfortunately, as young people in our lives, we haven't ever learned to receive. A lot of times because we never felt that we were given. But a human person is made for love, to give love and to receive love. And you can see this circle, this cycle, to give and to receive. And even just me doing that with my hands, the circular motion. To give and to receive. You can see that in Rublev's Trinity, for example, that there is an inherent circle there that represents the Trinity. If we are human beings imaging God, that there's a reception of love, a giving of love. That's the communion within the Trinity. That's who we image as human persons. And so we have to be able to receive. Sometimes there's blocks in our life. Sometimes we're not prepared to receive it, to appreciate it. And there can be days. We have to recognize this in classrooms. We know sometimes our students, when we're looking at them, we know that there's something not right. They mightn't be in that place. We don't know what happened in their day. And also just in this receiving, that not all artwork, like I mentioned before about some of the artwork that I encountered in the museum at Philadelphia, not all the artwork is given in a way as gift. Sometimes it's maybe on the part of the artist that it's more egocentric. And we have to be aware of that, especially in our selection of what we are hoping is beautiful. And that's why it's so important to be very selective. What a hint in this regard is to see what has stood the test of time. And we know we're so grateful in our church because we have so many beautiful artworks. And I would invite you to, if you're not doing so already, to continue to look for beautiful artworks. And if you go in on the websites of any of the great museums, you can get high quality images. And that's just talking about artworks. You know, there's so much access to beautiful poetry and also to immerse ourselves in beauty through creation. And so we have the answer. You know, if we're supposed to see through beauty, see in the beautiful, that pathway, that bridge to God, the key to receiving is this purity of heart. That we have to unclutter our hearts. That's what silence, that's what contemplation is. It's losing ourselves, losing everything that's important to us or what we think is important in life, money, wealth, prestige, honor. Just immersing ourselves in God and receiving what the gifts that he wants to give us to use for others. Blessed are the pure in heart. They shall see God. They shall see beauty. First time I saw this image, I was so struck by this image. It's of a homeless man. A lawyer gave up his profession because he wanted to live his passion, which was photography. And so much of his work, I think his surname is Ales, A-L-E-S. So much of his work is to go amongst the homeless people, not to use them, not to take photos of them and then to use them for his own goods. He became famous through this, but it's because people resonate. He's looking at the dignity in every single human person. And we can look at this guy. Obviously, his eyes are so striking, but what about the broken nose? There's a scar on his nose. The disheveled hair, the embedded dirt under his eyes. But there's beauty here in this person who's loved by God, who is the image of God. Every single human person, if we slow down and seek to know that person as a gift to the world by God, we will see the face of Christ. This is the icon from St. Catherine's Monastery. It's one of the earliest icons of Christ Pantocrator. And when we look at it closely, if we look at, as we face it, the right side, we can see the swollen eye and the bruised cheek and the bruised lips on the right side. And I won't spend a lot of time, but I would invite you again to look at the history, the meaning of this beautiful iconography. But it's Christ looking at us. It is Christ. It is the third privileged way. We looked at creation on the mountain. We looked at Arthurian, Leonardo da Vinci and Fra Angelico. Looked at the writing of St. Augustine from his book, Confessions. But everything, we're always seeking this encounter with Christ. To see God, this is from NASA, from the Hubble telescope. It's nicknamed the Eye of God. It's a nebula. But to look always for the encounter with God. And I want to show you another little clip here now in order just to show the connection between our souls and that relationship with God, but also to be aware of the beauty of creation, but also the music. And it will be music that you'll recognize.
Thank you.
Okay, I'm going to close off. There's really so much more that we could spend time with, but I'm going to close off here, and you're going to see me jump a few slides, but let's just think in terms of education. What we're trying to do is we're helping them to develop a critical spirit to discern the good, to use their senses, like I've been saying, to slow down. And all of this is all to encounter Christ. I'm just going to jump quite a few slides. An artwork like this, the Annunciation by Bartolomeo Murillo, can be used for any age. It can be used for any age. I've used this with primary school children. I've used it with when I've taught primary school teachers. What do you see? What can they mean? What do you wonder about? I'm asking you this question too. But these are the same questions we can ask any person of well-selected artworks. Can you see the triangle? The upper point, the Holy Spirit. The bottom left-hand angle, the arms of the angel Gabriel. Our Lady's elbow, the right angle. Look at the hand of the Archangel Gabriel. Look at the direction of his hand passing through the womb of Our Lady to the word, the scripture on the left-hand side. The word was made flesh and dwelt amongst us. The Holy Trinity was revealed in this moment. Today is the feast of St. Thomas the Apostle. This is for us. I mean, I wouldn't recommend showing this to children. What's happening here? Why is Jesus holding Thomas's hand? Because it pains him. But he's willing to suffer so that Thomas will know the truth. Look at the wonder and amazement in Thomas's eyes. Or maybe even, I still don't understand this. Help me, Lord. But the gentleness and the firmness that Christ has. Is Caravaggio, maybe Caravaggio is saying something about himself. Look at Peter looking on, thinking, I betrayed my Lord and my God three times. Caravaggio, it was messed up. But some of the most beautiful artworks were made at his hand. And then the contradiction, the invitation from Christ crucified. There was no beauty in him, but he is beauty himself. He's looking at us. This is for us. We can't share what we don't have. We can't give what we don't have. That's Sherry Waddell. We have to know Christ more and more every day. More and more every day. And the way that we know that we do this most perfectly, the way that we unite ourselves with the beautiful beauty incarnate, despite the fact that this is a mystery, that we can never understand everything, but what we do know, what we do understand, let us love and ask for more. Thank you.